phone, they like the true blood, they like the immune system, they like some aspect of information, and of course their brain is more minimal than the brain. Now, on the other end of the spectrum, it's for modeling instance for lifespan, for aging, disease, mouse and zebra patients, they use a lot of horrific genetic models, but there are relatively low left one from mouse, you can have fingers, so you can do pretty much one experiment, but it's very expensive as well. So we saw that dead fish really filled an important need. It filled a gap, basically. Because the body of fish is preserved, but it had all those organs and tissues, but it lived very short. So it is in the order of the human brain model. So what is this African killer fish? It originates as a baby from Africa, from Zimbabwe and Burundi, but they are sort of visited all over the world, and they tend to habitate. So probably very extreme, unsevering type of habitat. And it is only the only short-lived of all, but the shortest-lived of all is dead African killer fish. And where is it in Zimbabwe and Burundi? It's a rural transient pond of water that stay around undergoing a very brief period of time called during the rainy season, and then the pond completely dry up during the dry season. So the fish is presumably adapted in evolutionary time to have an extremely low fecundity rate and generate an egg population during the rainy season, have an extremely short egg cycle and egg time here, and then in order to survive the dry season, it has to survive growth. So the main survive growth is by having the embryos then proceed to suspended animation called diapause, but it can survive for years actually, and then when water comes about, the whole cycle starts again. So, in the lab, those fish, you can maintain them in place for water, so you can keep this state of diapause, and you can really have a short life cycle here. And we allow you guys to know, when you join my lab, and then after you join back several times, in fact, the members of my lab came to us, we captured different populations of this fish all across the Limpopo River, that's going from here in Zimbabwe, all the way to Mozambique, into the ponds that are coming out of the drainage system for this. It's a feature in the lab. Which means that those African killer fish, they are, they can escape their short lifespan. Now, the shortest fish that can reproduce in captivity, 34 to 6 months, despite the fact that they are short, they don't display 80 kilobytes. They have fertility decline, unfertility decline, very effective, no black freedom, that sign of neurodegeneration as well. There is a different strain from all those different forms, and they exhibit different types of lifespan genes, which is actually going to help identify genes that are important for lifespan. But to me, when we have this fish, we're going to take all of them, and this is a fantastic try, and a justified different cures, for example, that's lifespan. But think about what we're missing, all the genetic and genetic tools that are so necessary to be able to manipulate the system or even to identify genes in that system. So that's what the agent was going to have set out to do, which is to really design a platform, a genetic and genetic platform for the African killer fish. And so it's helped by them, that they also have two concepts of many conditions to help for people in the field. So what we went ahead and did is basically the most for sequencing and assembling the genome of this fish. We have several genomic assets for the transcription, the genetic, which helps us annotate the genome. So it's really nice now because that's, you know, related to the genome effect for the community. So if you have a favorite gene, you can see what the gene overlap are in the short list fish and potentially the variants that we had in this fish. But still, it did not allow us to manipulate it. So really what made a big difference was CRISPR-Cas9, the genome editing tool. So what we decided to do is edit a number of genes, which mutate a number of genes that have been implicated in pathways and genetically in what's called the hallmark of aging, like the unit of the specificity that indicates that basically for aging, there are about 9 hallmarks for the nutrients, genders, formatting mutation, telomere damage, stem cells, the APOE, genes for neurodegeneration, senescence aspects, mitochondrial dysfunction, etc. So we took genes all across the 9 hallmarks of aging and asked, basically, can we use the CRISPR-Cas9 technology then to create them and have different fish that can recapitulate some of the features, even of human effects? So that's exactly what we did. I'm going to present you examples, because we use that as an example for telomerase. It's very important for human aging. In fact, there are humans that have effects in terms of enzyme that is important for stopping the telomere at the genome. So humans, you can have some mature, find the pressure eating, so they have defects in their stem cells, they can actually ignore their stem cells maturing. And so, to summarize what we did, we just inject CRISPR-Cas9 on the first gene, which helps you make a specific deletion in the first gene, in the genome, so it's really very wide open, yet it's a very specific aspect genome editing in the fish. And what's nice is that, even if the other, oops, sorry, the telomere biologists can recognize that wild type fish can, not normal fish, that we can elongate telomeres, but fish that are deficient, that have this mutation, can no longer elongate their telomeres. But you cannot, but the fish cannot elongate their telomeres, like humans, they are outwardly normal at first. So then, so the fish are actually outwardly normal.